We are currently standing at 527 for individuals injured, and individuals that have died or passed away, 59.
An unimaginable human toll in the Las Vegas massacre. Also, new details emerging about the shooter, but they don't seem to answer the big question here. Why? Good morning and welcome to Early Start. I'm Christine Romans in New York.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dave Briggs. It's Tuesday, October 3rd, 4 a.m. in the East, just after 1 a.m. local time here in Las Vegas. We welcome our viewers in the United States and around the world. Just over 24 hours since the worst mass shooting in modern American history. The headline is not what we know at this hour. It's what we don't. The motive. Why did 64-year-old Stephen Paddock open fire from his 32nd floor window at the Mandalay Bay behind me? He killed at least 59 people, injured more than 500, as 22,000 concert goers ran for their lives in all directions. Authorities have recovered an astonishing 23 guns from the shooter's hotel room, 19 more from his home in Mesquite, Nevada. We'll have more on what we know about the gunman in just a moment. But now investigators have started piecing together how the attack happened and how it was stopped. Officials say a team of six officers spoke with security at the Mandalay Bay, searched the hotel floor by floor until they found the gunman's room. The smoke alarm allegedly pointed them in the right direction. The shooter fired at the officers through the door, forcing the SWAT team to move in.
Copy. All units on the 32nd floor. SWAT has explosive breach. Everyone in the hall needs to move back. All units move back.
Breach.
SWAT officers moved in, finding the gunman had already killed himself. Question haunting investigators and victims this morning, their families wondering why. Why did a man described as a retired accountant with no known history of violence, no known connections to hate groups or terror groups, suddenly arm himself? The answer is certainly elusive at this hour. Jean Casares joins us now. She's been investigating Stephen Paddock. And has anyone found any inkling as to why he committed this heinous act?
No, and you know what's interesting? Law enforcement said yesterday that he was not on their radar. They had had no interactions with him in any of the cities that he ever lived in. No criminal background at all. But they did say that at least one of those weapons that he had altered to allow it to be an automatic weapon. And weapons he had, and I think that's the shocking thing about this, because in that hotel room, which is right behind us there, the Mandalay Bay, they found 23 guns, including a handgun and many rifles, some with scopes. They believed he used numerous weapons during the carnage that he committed at 12:08 yesterday morning. Also in his home, there were 18 weapons, explosives, hundreds, thousands of rounds of ammunition and electrical devices. His car, there was ammonium nitrate and fertilizer. And we don't know what was found in the Reno house. You know what we haven't heard at all about? Are electronic devices, computers, laptops. That can be a bevy of information right there to go to the state of mind, because they really want to understand why. They want to classify this, and they can't do it until they find his state of mind. And he's not around anymore to talk to. Here's something else. His father not only was a convicted bank robber, but he broke out of prison in 1966. He was on the run. He was on the FBI's most wanted list from 1966 through 1997. But his brother Eric said that he and his brother didn't know him. They weren't close. That his brother Stephen never wanted the limelight and wouldn't do something like this. He never wanted to be photographed, just sort of a quiet person. He said, my brother's the type that just sort of wanted to eat a burrito.
Yeah, Taco Bell. We haven't heard much from friends. It doesn't appear there are any friends. What about this girlfriend, this roommate, Mary Lou Danley? Do we know anything about her?
It's mysterious, too. Authorities finally said, we heard out of the country. We heard last night Tokyo is where they believe she is. When she left, we don't know. They lived together. That was his girlfriend. Why did she leave? Will she come back? Will she talk to authorities? Someone has to know something. Has to know something, because if you look at the amount of weapons And one of the guns we know he got in April, springtime, here in northern Nevada, north Las Vegas, you have to store them. You have to keep them.
This is an enormous arsenal, so she might be the focus of this moving forward, to your point. When did she leave? Why did she leave? Was she visiting family? She's one of the few people that can speak to, as Jean spoke about there, the state of mind of Stephen Paddock, because there's no trace of it, Christine. Nowhere, no digital footprint whatsoever.
You know, the only reason anybody cares about this guy, this coward, is because of the victims that he left behind, you know, and at some point his name will fade away. Hopefully there will be some answers to why.
Let's hope.
To be instructive going ahead. But the people who really matter here are a special ed teacher, a new husband, a Las Vegas mother of three, local residents and visitors from near and far. The people who really matter are not the cowardly shooter, but the people who were just enjoying life. They came from all walks of life. There are so many names and there's so many grieving families. I want to bring in CNN Scott McClain. He's at the University Medical Center in Las Vegas. He joins us live with more on the victims of this tragedy. Scott?
Hey, good morning, Christine. There are 59 victims of this tragedy. You mentioned the professions of some of them. Obviously, we're hoping and praying that that number does not change. But as you mentioned, the suspect in this case has gotten a whole heck of a lot of attention because we want to know his state of mind and why he carried out this attack. But I also want to tell you about some of the victims of this attack as well, and we're learning more about them. One of the victims is Rachel Parker. She was 35 years old. She was an employee of the Manhattan Beach Police Department. That's in California. She was a victim, she was shot at the concert. She died in the hospital. Sandra Casey was 35 years old. She was a teacher in Manhattan Beach, California, a special ed teacher at a middle school for the past 9 years. Rhonda LaRocque was 42 years old. We know that she was a victim because of a Facebook post that her sister made. In it, she says that her heart is broken. She feels numb. She feels paralyzed because of her sister's death. She says she'll be turning to God for comfort, just as her sister Rhonda would have wanted her to. Bailey Schweitzer was only 20 years old. She was from Bakersfield, California. According to our affiliate KBAK TV, she was watching the concert with her mother when she was fatally shot. We also know that she was a cheerleader and a volleyball teacher, or a volleyball player, I should say. And Nasa Tonks was a Las Vegas resident. She was also a mother of three kids named Caden, Braxton, and Grayson. Her employer confirmed her death. Now, aside from all of the confirmed victims, Christine, we also know that there are some people who are still looking for their loved ones. I ran into one woman today who is a family friend of a man named Derek Taylor. He is 56 years old. He is from Oxnard, California, and he is missing right now. He was staying at the Paris Hotel. He never checked out. He had a flight back to California. He never got on it. His family today, I spoke to them on the phone. They have been calling the hotline that officials have set up for people to be reunited with their missing family members, especially considering the number of people who left their phones behind. And so they haven't gotten any answers yet. One of his sons will be here tomorrow to try to piece together those answers, but you can be pretty sure that this is not the only family that is trying to get some confirmation of what happened to their loved one. Dave.
Yeah, and they're setting up some free rooms here at the Bellagio. I know Southwest Airlines is trying to help fly in some of these people, so everything is being done to make these victims' families as comfortable as they can be as they search for their loved ones. Scott, thanks so much. How do you pinpoint a motive when a man with no criminal history goes on the deadliest shooting rampage in modern American history?
Our unity cannot be shattered by evil. Our bonds cannot be broken by violence. And though we feel such great anger at the senseless murder of our fellow citizens, it is our love that defines us today. And always will, forever.
President Trump playing that role of comforter in chief before traveling here to Las Vegas tomorrow to directly address the deadliest mass shooting in modern U.S. history. He read a subdued statement saying the nation is united and sadness, shock, and grief. His spokeswoman, Sarah Sanders, became emotional, describing the heroism we witnessed as the attack unfolded.
But what these people did for each other says far more about who we are as Americans than the cowardly acts of a killer ever could. The Gospel of John reminds us that there is no greater love than to lay down one's life for a friend. The memory of those who displayed the ultimate expression of love in the midst of an unimaginable act of hate will never fade.
The Concord Massacre reigniting the gun control debate here in this country. Democratic Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut, who called for legislation after the Sandy Hook shooting, releasing a statement saying it's time for Congress to, quote, get off its ass and do something. Gabby Giffords, who survived an assassination attempt in 2011, says she is praying for the victims and for her former congressional colleagues to find the courage to act on gun violence. Republicans also responding to the shooting, but largely avoiding the gun control issue. House Majority Whip Steve Scalise, wounded just months ago in the baseball practice shooting, saying in part, I encourage people across America to stand together in solidarity and to support the Las Vegas community and all of those affected in the face of unspeakable evil. Our whole nation must respond with countless acts of kindness, warmth, and generosity. One person who changed his mind quickly on gun control is a man named Caleb Keeter. He's the guitarist for the Josh Abbott Band, was on stage in Las Vegas just before the attack. Keeter, a self-described proponent of the Second Amendment, he now says, though, in a tweet, I cannot express how wrong I was. We actually have members of our crew with licenses and legal firearms on the bus. They were useless. Enough is enough. We need gun control. We need it right now. Jimmy Kimmel made an emotional late-night plea for gun control. Christine, as this debate will continue to rage here in the United States, if now's not the time, when is it?
We'll play a little bit of that Jimmy Kimmel sound, 13 minutes of monologue. This is just all very, very compelling. And Dave, I mean, this happens again and again. This, you know, you saw the president, you saw Sarah Sanders stand before the podium. If history is a guide, they will stand there. Situation, Dave, thanks. You know, before the president heads to Las Vegas, he is set to fly to Puerto Rico today to survey the damage from Hurricane Maria. President Trump and the First Lady are expected to arrive in San Juan around noon Eastern Standard Time. They will receive a briefing on relief efforts and meet with individuals hit hard by the storm. The pair will also meet with the governors of Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands. The visit comes as the administration tries to show progress in recent days. One FEMA administrator tells CNN he saw water trucks and fuel trucks making deliveries. He also says he spotted more open highways, improved cell service, and more relief in remote areas. Still, the Army Corps of Engineers says it would be up to 10 months before power. He sold more than 80 million records worldwide during a very long, distinguished career, working solo and with his band, The Heartbreakers. Petty churned out hits like Free Fallin', American Girl, I Won't Back Down. Petty was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame back in 2002. He was 66 years old. All right, that emotional late-night pitch for gun control from a late-night host getting deeper into the political debate. It has been more than 24 hours since a gunman opened fire from the 32nd floor of the Mandalay Bay Hotel in Las Vegas, and the search for answers so far, honestly, leading only to more questions. The gunman had no criminal record. Many of us struggling to figure out a motive for the deadliest mass murder in modern U.S. history. I want to bring in former NYPD Sergeant Joe Giacalone to talk a little bit about this, and you've been watching this unfold over the past 24 hours. Here's someone who is a retired accountant, someone who has 23 weapons in his hotel room, another 19 in his home, someone with really no social media profile, a live-in girlfriend, a family that he talks to occasionally that lives in Florida. No red flags here. This is 64 years old. One FBI profiler yesterday told us this is an outlier in terms of a lone wolf suspect.
Well, certainly. I mean, he throws off the entire, you know, plan about how to try to combat these guys. I mean, the closest thing that you can come to is the guy who shot everybody at the baseball game a few months back. Other than that, they're generally about 20 or 30 years old, and they have a very high social media profile. One of the things that I was, you know, looking at was hoping that we can find something so that we can, you know, say, all right, well, at least we have something to work on. Saying, all right, he said this or said that, or he belonged to a club or something like that.
But people around him say no real religious affiliations, no real political leanings. I mean, maybe this can change. It has been just 24 hours. Give me a sense, 40 guns. His brother said, oh, maybe he had a couple of handguns, maybe a long rifle. He had a case full of guns. Does 40 guns, is that a red flag?
I mean, I don't know about a red flag, but it just seems to be excessive. I mean, the amount of guns that this guy had. And not only that, he also had a bullet-resistant vest they found. And, you know, the fertilizer, or the ANFO, right. The ammonia nitrate, which they was used in Oklahoma City.
Right.
So his plan could have been a lot worse than what we even saw. So, I mean, there's something that... You know, they need to figure out what happened, what made this guy tick, and what his actual intentions were. Maybe he wrote something down somewhere.
Yeah. Well, I know there's a computer that they found in the hotel room, so clearly they're going over the computer. One wonders if he's, you know, he's some, you know, 64-year-old sort of, you know, sniper fantasy, cowardly behind the window on the 32nd floor. Like, what was going on in his mind? We may never know. But for law enforcement, Times Square... For you know, any kind of big event in any of America's big cities, how does law enforcement look at this?
Well, this is keeping police executives up at night. Anywhere that you have a big conference or you're going to have a large group of people, this is something that now has put a wrinkle in all your plans, because this is, we're looking at about half a mile outside of your security zone. Something that, you know, we're talking about presidential or Pope kind of details where you're right. You have counter snipers. And like, you don't do this for a concert. I mean, you don't. The Las Vegas Police Department, you know, and or any other police department, isn't prepared for this.
Right.
You don't have enough personnel. You don't have enough people, and it's a real concern. And if I was sitting right now, you know, on a planning stage, any of these things, the first question would be, how are we going to prevent this? Like, what do we do?
You're concerned also when you say something like the largest mass shooting in modern American history. You're worried about sick brains hearing that and being enticed.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I think I would hope that we just kind of tone down the largest mass shooting in history, because it gives some other person out there who his mind is bent to something to strive for, and that's a concern of mine. I mean, I think it should be a concern of everybody's.
You know, I got to tell you that I've done this before. I've been here before. We'll do it again. The president is standing in front of the podium for the first time yesterday. President Obama more than a dozen times stood up and had to deal with this. This is a uniquely American issue, isn't it?
It's an American problem for sure. I mean, we have, there never seems to be a right time to speak about it. We're not allowed to talk about it when the event is happening. And then after the event, we never talk about it either. So we need to figure out exactly when we're going to talk about it. Maybe we should make an appointment and say, you know, on such and such a date, that our Congress and every on Senate,
I mean,
we're going to talk about it.
We can't just accept this as the way it is. That every X number of months, there will be people who will be enjoying themselves who will be gunned down. We can't just accept that.
No, it is unacceptable, and we shouldn't accept it. And, you know, as a collective people, we should, you know, demand that our representatives do something about this. You know, loosening laws right now is probably not the greatest idea. I mean, we have something going through, I think, the Senate right now, or the Congress, about, you know, silencers and stuff like that. I mean, listen.
As a law enforcement professional, how do you feel about making it easier to buy and use silencers?
Yeah, I don't think you're going to have any cop that's going to ever tell you that, you know, they hope that more people can get guns, especially silencers and stuff like that, especially after the ambush attack that we saw last year against law enforcement. I think that's the last thing that they want to see.
This girlfriend, this woman, the mystery woman, who is apparently out of the country, what do you think investigators will be pursuing with her? And can we assume that there's an FBI team right now debriefing her?
Yeah.
They're not just going to wait for her to come home, right?
Right, yeah. I think it would be silly to think that we're just going to, you know, okay, well, when you're done with your vacation, come back. You know, this, she's a key component in this. She's lived with him. I mean, you can't live with somebody and not notice all these guns around. He might have talked about it. They're not married, so there's no, like, you know,
right.
Privilege there. So they can be able to... you know, try to get some information out of her. And listen, it's an eyebrow raiser, let's put it that way.
One of the things about this case is that there's some people who are, you know, is this domestic terror? Is it terror? Are there any links to, you know, any foreign groups? Does it matter? Is there a reason to try to figure out how to label this?
The only reason why I could think is that we're so polarized right now that each group, each side is just dying to blame it on the other. I mean, it's really gotten to a point where we need to come together as a collective people and just, you know, it is what it is. It's a label. You want to put it as a label? It's very pejorative. We know that. But from a legal standpoint, right now it doesn't rise to the level of domestic terrorism, because there's a couple of factors missing. If we can prove that through motive, whatever, I'm sure our government's going to be more than willing to label this as domestic terrorism. But until then, we need to wait and let investigators do their job.
The only, you know, this guy has kind of like a plain vanilla kind of background, except, you know, the gambling is interesting, but he lives in Nevada. So, you know, the video game, $100 a hand video game gambling he did. But it's interesting. I saw that his dad in the 60s and 70s was on the FBI's most wanted list. So there is something here. That is the only other odd thing I saw about his background.
Yeah, I mean, we never want to blame people for the sins of their father, so to speak. So, I mean, that may or may not be any issue with this, but something along the line has changed this guy's mind about what he wanted to do. And that's where law enforcement has to figure out exactly what made him finally decide to do this. I know people use the word snap or whatever it is. Let's figure it out, because if there are warning signs,
right,
we might be able to tell people, say, if you see this, you know, let somebody know, because this could be a problem.
And it looks so premeditated, not like a snap. 3 days in there, bringing all those guns. I mean, I don't even know how you get that many guns into a hotel room without being spotted. Joe Giacalone, come back again in a few minutes. We'll talk more about this case and the investigation as it proceeds here. Early Start continues right now.
We are currently standing at 527 for individuals injured and individuals that have died or passed away.
Time, we are just over 24 hours since the worst mass shooting in modern American history. The headline, not what we know at this hour, it's what we don't. The motive, why did 64-year-old Stephen Paddock open fire from his 32nd floor window at the Mandalay Bay here behind me? He killed at least 59 people, injured more than 500 as 22,000 panicked concertgoers ran for their lives. Authorities have recovered an astonishing 23 guns from the shooter's hotel room, 19 more from his home in Mesquite, Nevada. We'll have more on what we know about this gunman in just a moment. But now investigators have started piecing together how the attack happened and how it was stopped. Officials say a team of six officers spoke with security at the Mandalay Bay, searched the hotel floor by floor until they found the gunman's room. The smoke alarm reportedly helped them locate the exact room. Smoke from the weapons, of course. The shooter fired at the officers through the door, forcing the SWAT team to move in.
Copy. All units on the 32nd floor. SWAT has explosive breach. Everyone in the hall needs to move back. All units move back.
Breach.
SWAT officers moved in, finding the gunman had already killed himself. The question haunting investigators and, of course, the victims' families this morning is why. Why did a man described as a retired accountant with no known history of violence, no known affiliations with hate groups or terror groups, suddenly arm himself? The answer proving elusive at this hour. Gene Casares joins us live here on the scene in Vegas. You are here right away from the beginning of this attack. What do we know about 64-year-old Stephen Paddock?
We know that he's 64, lives in a retirement community in Mesquite, Nevada. His brother describes him as 6'2" tall, so a large man. But the way his brother describes him is anything but what the reality is. His brother says that he loved video poker, that it was a job to him, but it was fun to him. He loved getting the free drinks. He loved getting the shrimp. He would sit there. He said that his brother just liked nothing more than to take a cruise and to eat burritos, that he would send his mother just boxes of, you know, big boxes of cookies. I mean, that's just like the perfect son. That's the perfect brother. So what's missing here? There's something more to the picture. You know, when you look at the amount of weapons, Christine was just mentioning it in that last segment, 23 weapons were found in the hotel room. And early on, police said that they thought that he brought the weapons in himself. They're combing through surveillance video right now.
Rounds and rounds of ammunition as well. And when you talk about 23 weapons, all the ammunition and 19 more at the home, thousands of dollars. Is there any sense of how he made his living, how he had the money to buy all these weapons?
He was an accountant. We know he had real estate. But how he made all that money? Through accounting, through real estate, through video poker? You know, another interesting aspect of this, there have been search warrants executed on the hotel room that is behind us, on the home in Mesquite, in Reno, Nevada, the property. We don't know the full inventory. We've heard some details of things that were found in the room, such as the guns and explosives and electrical devices and ammonium nitrate in the car and fertilizer. We don't know the complete inventory. We don't know if they will make that public, but that could provide some hints. And maybe they have a pathway now to discover more of the whys, his state of mind.
We've heard almost nothing about friends of the shooter. What about this girlfriend? What do we know about her?
Well, she's in Tokyo, so she left the country, and authorities really are going to want to talk with her. We have FBI overseas. We have FBI in Tokyo. So whether they're sending someone from here or someone there, they obviously are going to ask her a lot of questions, and hopefully she will talk to them.
Indeed. Mary Lou Danley, initially reports were she was in the Philippines seeing family. Gene points out she's now in Tokyo, and that, Christine, has to be the focus in terms of getting some background about this character, some inclination as to why she left the country. Did she know about this massive stockpile of ammunition and weapons, and what did she think he was using them for?
Yeah, it's remarkable. I'm sure authorities are going to have so many questions for her to sort of fill out the picture of this dead shooter. Yeah. All right, Dave, you know, the victims here are the most important to spotlight: a special ed teacher, a new husband, a Las Vegas mother of three, local residents and visitors from near and far. They are the names that matter in this mass shooting. They came from all walks of life. There are so many of them, 59 of them, leaving behind 59 grieving families. CNN's Scott McLean is at University Medical Center in Las Vegas. He joins us live with more of the victims of this tragedy. Scott?
Hey, good morning, Christine. So much attention has been on the suspect in this case because people want to get a sense of what his motivation was for carrying out this horrendous crime. As for the 59 victims, we know what their motivation was for being at that concert. They simply just wanted to enjoy some country music with their friends and really enjoy themselves. And they all leave behind people, family and friends, and we want to show you who some of these people were. And so one of the victims is named Jennifer Irvine. She's from San Diego. She was an attorney, a black belt in Taekwondo. She practiced hot yoga. She was also an avid snowboarder. Another victim, his name was Sonny Melton, just 29 years old, a registered nurse from Tennessee. His wife was one of the survivors of this shooting. Jenny Parks, another victim, 35 years old, a kindergarten teacher from California. Her husband was also wounded, and her school district said that she was, quote, truly one of the most loving people you could ever hope to meet. Susan Smith was just 53 years old. She was a mother and an office manager from California. She was married with two adult children. And Angela, or Angie Gomez, was just 20 years old from Riverside, California. We know that she was one of the victims because, or at least according to the Riverside Unified School District, her employer, who said she was fun-loving, had a great sense of humor, and always had a smile on her face. We should also not lose sight of the fact that there are a lot of people still recovering in hospitals. Some of them have a long fight ahead of them. Just at UMC alone, there are 12 victims still in critical condition, and others will still have a long way to go for recovery. I spoke to the family of one woman named Taylor Barr, just 22 years old. She was shot in the arm. She lost a lot of blood on the way to the hospital. She still has movement in her hand, but not a lot of feeling. She's going to require probably two, maybe three more surgeries in order to really repair some of the nerve damage that was done. And one more thing to mention, Dave, and that's that officials appealed to people in Las Vegas for blood. The response, absolutely overwhelming, to the point where a blood clinic today, or yesterday, I should say, was actually turning people away.
It's an incredible outpouring of generosity. Thank you, Scott. I flew in with some officials from the American Red Cross. They were stunned at how many people had lined up at 2 a.m. when the shooting took place at 10 p.m. They didn't even open to donate blood until 7 a.m. People here in Vegas doing what they can. We should also mention the Bellagio Hotel trying to get some free rooms for the victims' families that are coming to town. Allegiant Airlines, based here in Las Vegas, trying to do their part as well to get the victims' families here, still searching for answers, many of them wondering where their loved ones are. Aside from the more than 40 guns, authorities have very little to work with as they search for a motive in this awful attack.
To the room.
Yes, video surveillance plays a key role now in every investigation, and we know it's probably Las Vegas is the most surveilled place, right? Even we think New York City is, but with all those casinos and all that money, I would probably say Las Vegas. So yes, they're going to have a lot of video evidence. You know, we also have cell phone records that we're going to be looking at, internet records. These are the what I can refer to as the the forensic horsemen, so to speak.
Right.
And they're going to be looking into these things, and there's going to be hours of footage. And it's not very exciting to watch video surveillance, and you have to do it step by step.
Hopefully they've got a lot of help from a lot of different law enforcement. You know, Dave, we were talking here, Joe was talking about also his concern about calling this the largest mass shooting in modern U.S. history. There are other sick minds out there. There will be more shootings, Dave.
Yeah, indeed there will be, unfortunately. Joe, a couple of questions for you. And one is, you've seen this video over and over again, and some law enforcement and analysts have said that doesn't sound like the incident. There are some that dispute that notion, some that suggest there was actually 72 minutes, an NBC News report, from the time the shots opened to the time they penetrated the room on the 32nd floor of the Mandalay Bay behind me. Why would it take so long?
Well, I mean, they have to figure out exactly where this was coming from. I mean, even the people on the ground, even watching the videos, nobody knew where the fire was coming from. They're saying now that a fire alarm actually cued them in onto something. And it's, you know, it's Las Vegas at 10 o'clock at night. Probably nobody is in their hotel rooms. So they're all out on the streets. Who's really innocent in this? And listen, sure. If you do something wrong, too, then people are going to ask you a million questions and say, why didn't you wait? Why did you do this? So in law enforcement, it's always... You know,
Yeah. You're
not moving fast enough, and then, you know, when something goes wrong, what did you do?
Does sound as though that smoke alarm was pivotal in finding exactly where the room was. Those weapons generate an awful lot of smoke. Joe, thank you. Ahead, President Trump forced to fill a role no president ever wants, but every president must.
Families of the victims, we are praying for you. And we are here for you.
President Trump travels here to Las Vegas tomorrow. More of his response to this awful shooting next on Early Start.
Our unity cannot be shattered by evil. Our bonds cannot be broken by violence. And though we feel such great anger at the senseless murder of our fellow citizens, it is our love that defines us today. And always will, forever.
President Trump heading to Las Vegas tomorrow to directly address the deadliest mass shooting in modern U.S. history. He read that subdued statement saying the nation is united in sadness, shock, and grief. And his spokeswoman, Sarah Sanders, she became emotional describing the heroism we witnessed as the attack unfolded.
But what these people did for each other says far more about who we are as Americans than the cowardly acts of a killer ever could. The Gospel of John reminds us that there is no greater love than to lay down one's life for a friend. The memory of those who displayed the ultimate expression of love in the midst of an unimaginable act of hate will never fade.
The Concert Massacre is reigniting the gun violence debate. Democratic Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut releasing a statement saying it is time for, quote, Congress to, quote, get off its ass and do something. Gabby Giffords, who survived an assassination attempt, a mass shooting in 2011, she says she is praying for the victims and for her former congressional colleagues to find courage to act on gun violence. Republicans also responding to the shooting, but largely avoiding the issue of how to address gun violence. House Majority Whip Steve Scalise, wounded in a gun attack just months ago, said this: I encourage people across America to stand together in solidarity and to support the Las Vegas community and all of those affected. In the face of unspeakable evil, our whole nation must respond with countless acts of kindness, warmth, and generosity. Another emotional, heartfelt plea from late-night host Jimmy Kimmel last night, reacting to the tragic shooting in Las Vegas where he grew up.
Here we are again in the aftermath of...
Well, Dave, Jimmy Kimmel, this is an exercise Americans go through
far too frequently. There is always a political fight on the back end that just fades away. Immediately you have people using that terrible phrase, gun control. What we're talking about here is gun violence, gun murders. We're talking about something that affects so many different families, yet our leaders can't seem to have a grown-up discussion about it.